Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. God bless you.
That's a little loud.
Let's try that. Okay, again.
Good morning.
God bless you. I'm glad you're here. It's summertime. Aren't you glad? I'm glad. And it seems like we're enjoying our summer, even though we have these ups and downs of weather, right? We're dealing with it because why? We're New Englanders. We know how to deal with weather. So I welcome you and I call your attention to the announcements page. And first thing I would like to say is I want to thank so much Bill Murphy and Eric O'Day for joining us today. Did I say that right? Very good. And we welcome Brenda, Eric's mom, with us today. Thank you so much for being here and providing music to open our hearts, to edify us, build us up in the Spirit, and to open our hearts to the Word of God. So we thank you and welcome you. I like having a little different vibe, so it's great. Thank you. And I want to also mention some other announcements. Please lock your cars if you're here visiting or because there have been a rash of they just open your car and it's unlocked and rifle through it and take whatever small change they can find. And there hasn't been any vandalism, but you don't want people going through your mail and book box or whatever. There are several things happening this week. The men's coffee meets on Wednesday. The deacons meeting will meet on Thursday at 10:15. And of course, our Friday morning dwelling place is always active in praying for all the things that this church cares so much about, and they're really going deep, building deepening their well of Holy Spirit experience. So we thank you for Michael leading that, and for the others who have led when we've been away or Michael's been working. So thank you, because it doesn't necessarily take a facilitator to lead prayer. Anybody can do it anytime. There are other announcements on that page, and I call your attention to those. And I also want to thank Sweetman Farm for the beautiful flowers today. And if anyone needs flowers, they're so reasonable there. We like to support our local farms. So thank you for the beautiful flowers. Thanks to Marilyn for picking them up. We are very glad. Now, you also have something different in your bulletin this week, and that is this colored page that shows what is recyclable. And as you know, we are embarking on a fundraiser for the bathroom that we are going to put into the church. And so you can see on the back of that page, there's some additional information. And isn't it surprising that all these things are recyclable? So believe it or not, if we take all these kinds of bottles to the redemption center, we get 5 cents, even though it doesn't say 5 cent redemption on the bottle. So please take those. If you drove into the driveway and parked in the parking lot, you saw all those bags that we are collecting, and shortly there will be, Michael loves this. So shortly we will have a sorting party. So we're going to lay all those things on the grass and rinse them if we need to, and sort them into the bags that the Redemption Center requires that we put them in, and we count them and we get our money right away. And I just want to encourage you that we have gotten a $10,000 anonymous match. So if the church raises $10,000, we get $10,000. So your 5 cent bottle is worth 10 cents. So don't throw away those bottles and cans. And my wonderful husband has told me that if we want to get $10,000 for the bottles and cans, that it means we only have to collect 200,000 bottles. Okay? So, you know, I am, my new name is up for the challenge. And so here we are. So thank you. Spread the word. Save your bottles and cans, and especially those that you think are not recyclable, okay? Thank you for that. And we're going to make a dent in the expenses associated with putting the bathroom in the church. Are there other announcements that I have forgotten? We are in backpack season, so if you haven't already gotten your backpack, I do want to say thank you. Our teens are covered. We have 4 backpacks all set for the teens. So any supplies, you don't have to fill a backpack. You can just bring your supplies here to church because we will be delivering to St. John. Justin's food pantry through this women's comprehensive health organization that is really dedicated to helping families in Hartland. So thank you in advance for that. Again, are there other announcements? Then let us enter a spirit of worship with our gathering hymn. You may stand as you are able to join Bill and Eric in Sing Low, Sweet Chariot. It is number 643 in your hymnal. Excuse me, 643.
Before we start, good morning. We're excited to play with you today. So the good news is the lyrics we're singing match up with the hymn. If you read music, we may be using some different notes than are in there, so what we're going to try to do to make that a little easier for you is each song we'll do a little bit of an intro so you get a feel for kind of like what key it's in and things like that. Okay? So I just wanted to share that. So for this one, it's just an instrumental intro, and then we jump right into the beginning of the first verse.
Sings my soul, my Savior God.
you. As we sing, we become aware of the greatness of God. And in that spirit, will you join me in the prayer of awareness? Lord, help our unbelief and call us into your rest. Help us to set aside the weight of the world, the cares of tomorrow, and the regrets of yesterday. We will take each day as a gift it is, a gift of grace, of mercy, and of love. We will look with new eyes at our world, all because of you. We are praying in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Scripture reading today is Romans 8:24-31. You can find it printed in the Word of Worship. We are saved by trusting. And trusting means looking forward to getting some things you don't yet have. Or if you already have something, you don't need to hope and trust that you will get it. But if we must keep trusting God for something that hasn't happened yet, it teaches us to wait patiently and confidently. And in the same way, by our faith, the Holy Spirit helps us with our daily problems and in our praying, for we don't even know what we should pray, nor how to pray if we should. But the Holy Spirit prays for us with such feeling that it cannot be expressed in words. And the Father, who knows all hearts, knows, of course, what the Spirit is saying as he pleads for us in harmony with God's own will. And we know that all that happens to us is working for good if we love God and are fitting into God's plans. For from the very beginning, God decided that those who came to him, and all along he knew who would, should become like his son, so that his son would be the first with many brothers and sisters. And having chosen us, God called us to come to him, and when we came, God declared us not guilty, filled us with Christ's goodness, gave us right standing with the God self, and promised us his glory. What can we ever say to such wonderful things as these? If God is on our side, who can ever be against us? Since he did not spare even his own son for us, but gave him up for us all, won't he surely give us everything else? Who dares accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? Will God? No. He is the one who has forgiven us and given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? Will Christ Jesus? No. For he is the one who died for us and came back to life again for us and is sitting at the place of highest honor next to God, pleading for us there in heaven. Who then can ever keep Christ's love from us? When we have trouble or calamity, when we are hunted down or destroyed, is it because he doesn't love us anymore? And if we are hungry or penniless or in danger or threatened with death, has God deserted us? No, for the scriptures tell us that for God's own sake, we must be ready to face death at every moment of the day. We are like sheep awaiting slaughter. But despite all this, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us enough to die for us. For I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Death can, and life can. The angels won't, and all the powers of hell itself cannot keep God's love away. Our fears for today's, our worries about tomorrow, or where we are, high above the sky or in the deepest ocean, nothing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God demonstrated by our Lord Jesus Christ when he died for us. Amen.
Please pray with me. Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Our God, our Rock, our Redeemer. Amen. So it is summer, and summer is supposed to be a time of rest. So I have a question. How many here today feel like they're resting? Really, show of hands. How many feel like they're resting? That's tough. It is tough. What are you resting from? What are we supposed to rest from? The cares of this world? That's a big one. The cares of life itself? Work? Are you resting from work? Are you resting from caring for a family? Are you resting from a potential diagnosis? Are you resting from worry, fear, anxiety? What do we need rest from? I think sometimes we need rest from the very world we live in. Just the nature of it. God is our greatest example of rest. Every translation of every Bible, every transliteration, which is not a direct translation of the Greek or Hebrew or Aramaic, every translation of Genesis 2:2 says the same thing. And by the seventh day, God had finished the work that he had been doing, and God rested on the seventh day from all his work. God had finished the work of creation, which was no small task, I think you'd admit. It was a big job. And frankly, whether it took 7 days, 7 weeks, 7 months, in our time, in our sense of time, our constraint of time, or if it took a day or 6 days in God's sense of time, it doesn't matter. God rested from all his work. So listen, if God rested, I think surely God felt that we need rest. God knew that, and God's word confirms it. Matthew 11:28, come to me, all who labor and are weary, and I will give you rest. Exodus 33:14, and God said, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Hebrews 4:9-11, there remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For anyone who enters God's rest also rests from his work, just as God did. Isaiah 26:3, great peace have they whose minds are fixed on God. God will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you, Lord. And finally, Psalm 62:1. Truly, my soul finds rest in God, where my salvation comes from. This is exactly what our scripture in the Epistle to the Romans picks up. And I know a lot of people use this scripture to explain the Holy Spirit praying through us. It's classic, and I would not take anything away from that. But I think if we look sort of in a more shallow way, then we find we need rest in these days. So where do we find true rest? The psalmist would say, our souls find rest in God, where our salvation is. It's where our salvation comes from. And so I propose to you that we find rest in trusting God. And I think that's all. In the midst of anything we face, trust God, and you will find rest. What today's scripture says is that we are saved to something. I think it's God's heavenly kingdom, and we are saved from something. We're saved from all kinds of things, especially from the things of this world. We are saved by trusting God. And I wonder, what happened to us when we were babies? You know, babies trust heights, living room, hearths. They trust table edges. They trust cliff edges as if nothing is going to happen to them if they just fall over. They don't have a fear of those things. And yet, babies and children have an innate fear of other things. And I wonder, what has happened to us? What are we supposed to fear, and what are we not supposed to fear? And it's a puzzlement to me, and I continue to think about it, but what I do know is that God calls us to come as children. And there's a reason for that. In fact, God's word says, unless we come as children, we will not enter God's heavenly kingdom. Here on earth, and the scripture says, the kingdom of God is near you, even in your mouth, as you speak the word, as you listen to the word. So we will not, unless we come as children, we will not enter God's heavenly kingdom, God's rest, either here or in the life to come. And I think maybe that's the key to rest as well. The key is trusting God, having faith in God's promises, and living according to God's word, which, I'm afraid to say, means obeying God in the small things and the big things. It means living by faith. So what's the alternative? Well, if we look back, the children of Israel gave us the greatest example of what not to do, to forego rest. What not to do. If you want to enter into God's rest, don't do what the Israelites did. In Hebrews chapter 4, God was very specific. God said to an entire nation, now I give you a perspective on this, the nation of Israel that was freed from Egypt. Remember, Egyptians couldn't believe that the Hebrews, this Hebrew nation, were procreating so fast, that they were creating so many, many more people in the nation of Israel. So there were over 1 million people in the nation of Israel when they were freed from Egypt. So you picture this. They're moving out of Egypt. They've been freed by God. They're now wandering in the desert. And God says to an entire nation, you shall not enter into my rest. Why? Because they did not mix their faith with their actions. They did not mix faith with actions. If you are struggling to rest, may I ask you to consider, are you mixing faith with your daily life? They didn't believe God when he freed them from Egypt that he would make good on his promise to give them the promised land, Canaan. They didn't believe it. And that is why the nation of Israel wandered in the wilderness and the desert for 40 years. Now God took care of them. Scripture tells us very clearly, their shoes never wore out. Their clothing did not tatter. They had food every day, water when they needed it, fellowship, worship, in fact. But that is why the nation of Israel wandered for 40 years, and every person who started out on that journey did not make it to the promised land, except for two adults, Joshua and Caleb, and all the children who had been born during those 40 years. Every adult, God told them, you shall not enter into my rest because you are not mixing faith with your life, because you didn't believe me. What an indictment. What a sentence that they didn't have to experience. God had promised them a land filled with milk and honey, and they just couldn't believe it. Now, all those children were born, did in fact enter in the promised land, and I asked them why. You know, I can sort of hear the children saying, are we there yet? Are we there? Are we close to the land flowing with milk and honey? You know, we went to the beach. I know people in Connecticut call it the shore, but I'm from Rhode Island, and we always called it the beach. A little less hoity-toity. It's the beach. And as a child, when we were driving to the beach, we would open the windows, and we would yell, who was the first one to smell the salt air? I smell it! I smell the salt air! We're close! And I can just hear the children of Israel. saying, are we close to the promised land? Can you smell the milk and honey yet? And their parents, who may not have even known that they weren't going to enter the promised land, that they were literally going to die off before they got there, would say, not yet, little ones, but we're on our way. That, friends, is how we trust God. We exercise our faith. We live according to God's word, and we obey in the small things and the big things. Psalm 119:60 says, I will hasten and not delay to obey your commandments. Don't try to compromise God. Don't try it. For God says very clearly, for the just shall live by faith. I used to serve in a very affluent community in a church, and I would often say that the people in that church didn't live by faith, they lived by purse. Because they had a bundle of money. Most everyone in that church had money. This is why when you go to a third world country and you see people who have nothing have such joy and such, right, just such living by faith, because they don't know anything else. And I think the children of Israel, because they weren't remembering, if you remember my sermon from many years ago, how the children of Israel, the adults on that journey through the wilderness, kept saying, I miss the melons and the cucumbers from Egypt. Oh. They had more faith in the melons and cucumbers from Egypt than they had in God's promise for the land flowing with milk and honey. What a shame. God says, the just shall live by faith. It's from Hebrews chapter 10. Listen to the verses from this letter to the Jews. Remember those days in the past when you first learned the truth? You had a hard struggle with many sufferings, but you continued strong. Sometimes you were hurt and attacked before crowds of people, and sometimes you shared with those who were being treated that way. You helped the prisoners. You even had joy when all that you owned was taken from you, because you knew you had something better and more lasting. So do not lose the courage you had in the past, which has a great reward. You must hold on so you can do what God wants and receive what God has promised. For in a very short time, God quotes, the one who is coming will come and will not be delayed. Those who are right with me will live by faith. But if they turn back with fear, I will not be pleased with them. That's a quote from Habakkuk. If you turn back with fear, I will not be pleased with you. But we are not those who turn back and are lost. We are people who have faith and are saved. Live by faith. It's worth it, don't you think? I mean, do you want cucumbers and melons, or do you want the promised land? It's just as simple as that. So we must believe that we are God's chosen. We must believe that Jesus was and is coming again. And we must believe in the saving work of Jesus, the work that he did, that he rested from after a very trying time. We must believe that Jesus is. And then we must believe in the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit, who does and is doing in us a work that helps us to pray, helps us to be pleasing to God, helps us to obey. Our scripture outlines it. And having chosen us, God calls us to come to him. And when we come, God declares us not guilty, filled with Christ's goodness, and gives us right standing with the God self, and promises us God's own glory. If we want real rest, we have to live by faith. We have to believe that we are God's people. And if we believe that, I assure you, it will show. You will be aware of it, and it will show to others. I will never forget the time I got on a plane right after a church service, going to a business, something or other, some requirement. And I sat in my aisle seat. I always sat on the aisle on the way out to a business event or whatever I had to do, and I always sat on the window on the way back so I could just lean and go to sleep. I sat in my aisle seat, and the man across from me looked at me and he said, are you born again? And I said, does it show? He said, yes, it does. When you live by faith, people will be drawn to you. People will know that you believe God and that you are destined for the promised land. So don't be afraid of it. You know in your hearts that it's true, right? Amen and amen. So let's confirm what God says in us and what the Holy Spirit is doing in us as we join together.
It will be my soul.
Thank you,
Father. Number 561. And just like the other ones, we're just going to do the chorus together, and then we might even jump in with the first one, okay?
We are a praying church. because we exercise faith when we pray. So there is a sheet in your worship folder that's all the prayer list, and I encourage you to take it, read it, lay hands on it, pray for those whose names appear there. We want to pray today for Dottie Bauer. She's really feeling pretty sick. She's nauseous. She's got a really bad headache. She just so wanted to come to church today. She came last Sunday, and everyone greeted her. It was wonderful to be in fellowship with her. And so please pray for Dottie. Let's pray together. Holy God, because you are the God of the universe, we come to you, and we ask for our sister Dottie to know your presence, to ease her pain, to ease discomfort, to bring the comfort that the Holy Spirit can bring, to pervade her household, pervade her very body, from the top of her head to the soles of her feet. Minister to her as only you can, Lord. Anoint her with your oil of gladness, the balm of Gilead. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. We continue to pray for Emily and Brian Williams. They were in a really bad car accident. The vehicle took out the whole front axle, and the car has been totaled. And so please pray for them. Pray please for Joni and Gus. They are dealing with significant health issues, and they're both in two separate rehab facilities right now, and dealing with what's going to happen when they're released, and they're just really struggling with the process of aging. So please pray for Joni and Gus, and for healing prayers for Paul and for his family, for Dick Lindgren, who is still recovering from surgery, and he's at the plane. Prayers for Sarah and her husband Pete and their daughter Mary, as Sarah is going to undergo brain surgery. Is that an update?
Yes, she did go for the surgery. It was 5 hours. It took her a couple of weeks to be able to speak again after the surgery. But now she actually called me the other day. I spoke to her husband, and then she called me back 2 days later, and now is able to sound again like herself. So I'll be visiting with her today. But it's just a trial that she's going through. It's the worst kind of brain
take our flowers to her today.
Thank you.
Okay? That would be lovely, right? Yeah, with our prayers. Lord, we continue to pray for Sarah. We thank you for her courage going through a third brain surgery. We thank you for the doctors and the medical professionals, everyone who attended to her. We know, as we pray for her, that you guided their hands, their hearts, their minds, their eyes. You focused them on the task in front of them. You are most familiar, Lord, with work. And so we know that you, if we allow you, you will work through us. We thank you, God, for healing Sarah and for ministering peace and grace and mercy to Pete and their daughter Mary. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. We pray for all of those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Grief isn't something that goes away. Gee, is it time for you to get over it? Haven't you gone through enough grief? That's not what grief is. Grief is a journey, and there are, I guess, scrapbooks to grief. So we pray for those who are still creating those beautiful scrapbooks. You know, ultimately, the scrapbook goes on the shelf, but occasionally you take it out and you look at it. So we pray, Lord, would you, in your grace and mercy, deal with all of those, bring comfort, bring the peace that passes understanding to those who are living a life of faith without their loved ones. We pray in the name of Jesus. We pray for all of those who are seeking employment, all of those who are on the journey to health and healing. We pray for all of those who care for those who are mentally ill, for those who are struggling physically, for those who are struggling with the aging process, with forms of dementia. We pray for all of those. We pray for those in our family who are waiting for reconciliation, waiting to be reconciled. If they are estranged, Father, make a bridge. Help us to cross it. We pray in the name of Jesus. Are there others for whom we may pray today?
I'd like to ask prayers for my brother Doug's family. wanted to say goodbye to Julia, who is passing from cancer. It's imminent that she'll be meeting the Lord, so I pray for joy for her in her passing and for comfort for the family.
Lord, we pray for the family and for Julia. And she's been struggling for a long time, and with great compassion, she has experienced the suffering of Christ in a very personal way. So we do ask, Lord, that you would minister to Julia and that she would rejoice in your arms. And that Doug and all the children and their spouses would rejoice with her as she graduates from this world into your embrace. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Are there others?
Prayers of healing for those who have no one to pray for.
For all of those, like the least of these, Jesus says, if you do it for the least of these, you do it for me. So for all of those who to us might be nameless, for all of those homeless, on the streets, in hospitals, in nursing homes, in prison, in psychiatric wards, we pray, Lord, you know each one. Each one is precious and a treasure to you. And so we pray for those whose names may not cross anybody else's heart or mind. Visit them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Will you join me in saying the prayer that Jesus gave us when the apostles said to him, teach us how to pray? Jesus said, pray this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Just as we lift our prayers to the throne of God, let us bring our offering to God Almighty, who has blessed us, who has provided everything we need, everything for life and godliness. Our morning offering will now be received.
Time waits not.
offer our lives as an offering today. We give freely our time and talents and our treasure to see you magnified in our world. Accept this offering that we present with grateful hearts. Amen. Dear friends, you heard the word rest today, and I hope you too take advantage of a Sunday to rest. Sometimes I go home after church, I don't know about you, but especially if the Holy Spirit has been working, and early in my Christian walk, I would go home from Sunday service and be absolutely exhausted. I think I just slept for hours and hours as the Holy Spirit did an amazing work of surgery in me to take out the things that were not needful and maybe put in some of God's grace, some of God's joy. So I hope that happens to you. I hope you leave some of these Sundays and go home and say, I'm exhausted. I can't believe how tired I am. I'm going to take a nap. And I hope you sense the Holy Spirit rest in you and around you. In the name of Jesus. And I bless you now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Will you join in singing, God be with you until we meet again. Thank you. God bless you.